Hello, good evening. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank this opportunity to join Mark in this tour in Ireland. I've been here once during your presidency of the European Union a couple of years ago, and I had the opportunity to talk in a conference here. But now the Students for Sensible Drug Policy and Graham, which I met several times around the world, invited me, and it's really a pleasure. My English is not as fluent as I would like, but I hope I believe it's better than your Portuguese, so I'll speak in English. I would start by saying that there's a lot of myths about the Portuguese policy. The Portuguese drug policy is known all around the world, mainly because of the issue of decriminalization, the decision of decriminalizing the use of every drug. And I believe it was a very important decision that we took 13 years ago. It was decided, approved by the Parliament in 2000 and came into force in 2001 in Portugal. It addressed every drug. I insist in that idea because we are talking mainly about cannabis, and but our solution was, in my view, going as far as possible within the prohibitionist paradigm, but going to the edge of that paradigm. According to one of the frameworks we had, the only one really, was to keep in line with the United Nations conventions at the time. We are talking about 13 years ago. But I would like to explain a little bit why did we take, we a small country, quite conservative, I would say, why did we take this this decision that was really innovative in the international panorama? And I believe that I think the historical way how the drug usage and drug-related problems started in Portugal was the main cause for this for trying this solution. In fact, as I believe you know, we lived for a long time under a dictatorship for 50 years. Portugal was completely isolated from the world, kept apart and in a redoma, defended from the evil of drugs, because if someone tried drugs at that time in Portugal, bad things could happen to them, really. During the dictatorship, the fascist dictatorship, drugs were not a problem, were not really present in our society. In fact, we had a small island of drug usage, mainly among health professionals, which is curious. People who could assess substances, and the largest number of people with problems of addiction and so on were could be found among those professionals. During that period, we were kept apart of things that were happening elsewhere in the world, in Europe. For instance, we were living a colonial war, the Portuguese Empire, with the colonies of Angola, Mozambique, Cape Verde, Guinea-Bissau, Timor-Leste. It was a huge empire, and since the beginning of the 60s, a colonial war began, where the people of those countries decided to fight for their freedom. And then thousands of people, of young people, were sent to the colonies to defend them, to fight against those liberation movements. While in Portugal, in the continent of Portugal, drugs were not an issue, in fact, among that people that were sent to the war, the regime incentivated the use, the abuse of alcohol and also of drugs to keep people happy doing that war. Suddenly, in 1974, we had our Carnation Revolution. You are too young to remember that, most of you, but maybe you heard about it. And suddenly everything changed. We were a society completely unprepared to deal with the drugs, while other societies in Europe had the capacity to adapt, to learn how to live with drugs inside them. We didn't have that capacity. Some movements that happened elsewhere, that the hippie movement, the students' movement in France, that kind of move, didn't touch us. Suddenly, in 1974, we had our revolution and everything changed. On one side, the return of those people, the soldiers and the settlers that were coming back from Africa, mainly from the colonies in Africa, with habits of using at least marijuana and bringing literally tons of it when they came back. On the other hand, the avidity that we had, I was 20 at the time, so I lived it personally. We were completely avids of trying it, experimenting it. So when the sudden availability, the association of the idea of freedom with the accessibility to drugs, there was a boom of experimentation. Everybody was trying cannabis, marijuana, and so on. Almost at the same time, we were a new emerging market, and other substances became available. And as we were completely naive about them, it was easy to shift from one to another. It was easy to be sharing a joint, sharing a joint. And someone said, I have something new, let's try it. Heroin or cocaine or whatever. And we were really unprepared to deal with this. And this led us suddenly to a big amount of, well, a boom in experimentation and in substance use, but also to problematic drug use, because heroin became, in a short period of time, became a very, very important problem in our society. Just 10 years after the revolution, we estimate that we had around 1% of our population. We are roughly 10 million inhabitants, quite stable. And by the middle of the 80s, we estimate that we had 100,000 people hooked on heroin, mainly injecting heroin. AIDS just came along almost at the same time, and it was really became a huge problem, public health problem, criminality problem, and it became the top political concern of the Portuguese people. The way that things happen in Portugal, I believe that led us to think about, or some movement in the society to consider the problems connected to drug use much more a health issue than a criminal issue. And it happened because it was completely transversal to all the society. It happened in all the social classes. It was not, the problematic drug use was not a problem mainly in disorganized or marginalized people. It was not a problem of lumpen. It was a problem that hit medium class, high classes, everybody. In a short period of time, it was almost impossible to find a single family in Portugal that had no problems connected to drugs. Drugs, let's read heroin. That was the epidemic that we faced. Well, and the state started when we had a lot of other priorities, other areas of deep changes in our society, but the society and the government had to face this problem because it became really the top political concern. In the Eurobarometer by the beginning of the 90s, when asked the common citizen on the street, when in those that kind of surveys, what is your main concern about the future of your children? And people would say spontaneously, drug and drug addiction. So, and as you know, politicians take that kind of problems. They have to face. They have to try to find solutions. What happened in our case, and I believe it was a clever idea, our former Prime Minister, José Sócrates, I don't know if you remember the name, was at the time, by the end of the 90s, in 97, he was the responsible for youth policies. And he decided to convene a group of experts of several areas, from judges to psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, and so on. And a group of nine people, I was one of those people. I'm a family doctor, and I started getting involved in this problem because I was confronted by people and families who asked help, and step by step I became completely engaged in this subject, and since 97 I only work in this area. As since 97 I'm the national responsible for the drug policy in Portugal, so I'm the long-lasting general director in my hierarchy that has survived to several governments and several political changes. Well, but in fact, what happened in that period, that group was, we were asked to have to produce a report on the national situation on drugs and to propose a strategy, how to deal with it. What shall I do? And the only thing that the minister at that time told us was, please keep within the framework of the conventions. A part of that, go as you wish and propose what you think it's the best thing to do. And we did so. The strategy that we proposed to the government in 98 has a chapter on supply reduction, on the activity of police, of customs, and so on, but is mainly, and I would recommend to people who are interested in this kind of documents to read it, because contains, it's available in our web page that can be, I can give you it in English, so you can. For instance, it has a definition of several concepts that are important to understand the nuance that are between legalization, decriminalization, depenalization, and so on. That's a lot of terms that do not mean exactly the same. And that kind of concepts are very important to the political definitions. Well, we proposed a set of, we had all the means to visit the top, the most progressive policies that were being taking place at that time. I recall 98. We went to Switzerland, we went to the United Kingdom, to Spain, we visited a lot of innovative responses, syringe exchange in prisons, for instance. It was consumption rooms, therapeutic heroin administration programs. Well, we had that opportunity to visit and to have contact with that. And then we proposed a strategy with a set of policies in terms of prevention, treatment. Methadone was not yet, at that time, completely consensual among the health professionals. There was a lot of discussion and pros and cons and big discussions about their use, but the strategy pointed it as a tool that should be available all over the country, and it became available suddenly. Discussions about harm reduction and the way that we address that idea of harm reduction, not with an idea based on the respect of the personal choices, and assuming that even if someone has the choice of using substances, he or she still deserves the effort of the state in order to provide him a better and a longer life. So in any circumstances. So the idea is not to let the people drop. And also in terms of reinsertion, of reintegration of people, we proposed positive discrimination towards employment, for instance, for drug addicts in recovery. We proposed the establishment of a network covering for state-run, for free, covering all the country and addressing all the needs that we could identify, and all that based on the idea that drug addiction is not a crime; it's not something that could improve with imprisonment. There's something that eventually can benefit from health support and social support. Consistently with this idea, we proposed, as the to wrap all this packet of measures, we proposed to decriminalize the use of every drug. Okay. As you can imagine, even if I can say this is among the common citizens, it was almost like a bottom-up movement. And I insist in the idea, in my view, it's because it was completely transversal to all the social classes. Today, when I discuss this with, for instance, with the Brazilians, they have a huge problem with crack, as you know. And some movements appear to trying to move in this direction, decriminalization, a more humanistic policy towards addicts, problematic drug users. But in fact, there's a rejection, because crack users are mainly the disorganized, the ugly, the dirty. You must keep them like that. That's the movement that the society makes. To develop this progressive policy, in my view, this is a very personal view of it, it came because exactly of the problem being attaining everybody, and if someone in medium class, a good Catholic who goes to the church every Sunday and discuss with the priest, my son is not a criminal, he's a sick person, he needs help, but he's not a criminal. And this idea made his way. Okay. So when we proposed to the politicians to, well, to bless this idea, it was quite easy. The government accepted all our proposals in terms of strategy to address the problem, except decriminalization, because it was not in the mandate of the government. It had to be discussed at the parliament. And there things were a little bit more complicated. The positions between the far left parties and the far right parties were completely explosive, with the, well, with some populistic fears being explored. Portugal will become a paradise for drug addicts from all over the world. We'll have planes every day coming to Lisbon with thousands of people to use drugs freely, when the idea was not to completely depenalize. Using drugs in Portugal is still forbidden. So it came out of the penal law. No one goes to jail, no one gets a criminal record for using drugs, but you can get a fine or alternative sanction. I can compare it with the fact of using or not using the safety belt when you drive. Okay? You don't go to jail, you don't go to a court, you don't have a trial for it, but you can have an administrative sanction. And that's what happened now in Portugal. I can explain you in detail how it works if you are interested. But I think it's important to give is this idea: why we could have this opportunity to decide, to propose, and to decide, and to have it approved. The majority of the parties were on the left side of the parliament, and the bill was approved. The right wing parties won the next elections, but they didn't try. The discussion was: shall we go back immediately? Shall we reverse this process or not? They decided to wait and see. Even UNODC, who visited us with a very critical attitude at that time, 2001, 2002, oh, you did so, you bandits, but decided also, let's see the results of this policy. The next government with a coalition from the right started to see that the evolution was positive, because all the available indicators that we had, very problematic, the AIDS numbers, the infections of the hepatitis, drug related deaths, the number of drug users, problematic drug users all in the world, started to drop since this. Of course, it was not the criminalization itself. It was the set of policies that was installed that led us to this evolution. But what we feel, what we felt, our professionals, everybody, all the families, even the police, we felt much more comfortable with this framework. For us professionals, it was quite strange, and don't forget we were coming out from a dictatorship. It was quite strange to have to face the fears of some of the drug users who were talking with us, doctors, medical doctors or psychologists, and repeatedly they asked, "Are you going to denounce me to the police?" It was something that was coming from the fascist period. So decriminalizing allowed us to have this, to make drop the taboo, to talk about this kind of problems openly. We can discuss it in families, in schools, in everywhere. Nobody fears to go to jail because he's using drugs. And it became really it became much easier to deal with it, with this problem, with the problematic drug user, or drug use, of course. Of course, as you know, the problematic drug users are, I dare to say, 10% of the people who use drugs. Hopefully, there's a lot of people who deal, who make drugs, who use drugs, and lives completely in balance with it. But the responses to those who have problems with it are really available and essential, in my view. It's important to have those responses in the health and social system to deal with the problems that may arise from that drug users. Well, since then, the evolution of all the available indicators has been positive. We feel quite comfortable with it. Now we have the right-wing coalition in power and there's no movement to reverse. I'm still in charge, so it's there's a broad consensus about our policy. I would say now we are not very much on the move. We have been we are receiving every day, every week at least, visitors from all over the world. There's a lot of interest about our policies. Yesterday I had a group of parliamentarians from Denmark. Monday, the previous Monday, I had a group of senators from California. People who are coming to visit us and to get the knowledge with our policies. We are proud of it. I think now it's our turn to wait and see a little bit. In the Eurobarometer, drug and drug addiction is now in the 13th place of priorities of the Portuguese people. So it's not a political issue. And I prefer not to have it as a political issue because with the right-wing coalition in the power to open in deep discussion can be to open a Pandora box that can lead us to lose some of the things that we obtain. I think our obligation now is to watch very closely and very attentively what is happening with the new paradigm that other countries, other states, so some states of the United States, Uruguay, and so on, are exploring. The new paradigm is the regulatory paradigm. Those countries are abandoning the prohibitionist paradigm and going into another step. There's a time to reflect on that, to watch closely what is going to happen, and I believe this is the way. And when it will take time, but I believe that to take drugs will become a choice of informed people, informed citizens that make their choices, assume some risks that can happen, but also have the responses they eventually need to deal with them. So, for the moment, of course, we could come into more detail if you want, but I think it's time to leave the floor for Mark, to tell you that I believe that in the next few years we'll have really new news. There's a lot of discussion going on in the preparation of the next UNGAS, the next United Nations Special Assembly in 2016. I don't believe that we'll have a miracle in between, but we'll have some nations and going on. And let me just leave in the end of my talk something that really bothers me in the discussion that is going on, which is mixing the discussion of therapeutic cannabis with the recreational use. I think those are different items that must be discussed in different contexts. The therapeutic use of cannabis is something for doctors, for the medicines agencies to discuss, to decide, is it possible to make the rules. The recreational use, I think it's another issue, at the same level of seriousness, but must be discussed in another context. Sometimes I feel very, very frustrated in some discussions where those things seem to go together, and it's not the same thing. If we want to be respected in that discussion, we must make it in a serious way and separate this kind of discussion. I don't know if you agree, but being the responsible for those policies in Portugal, having some responsibilities in the Europe's policies, I would like to live and feeling that you are people engaged in this kind of discussions, I would like to leave this note. And I have a question or a note from this friend.